All right, everyone, thank you so much for coming out so early in the morning. I appreciate you waking up, as I said earlier. And to those of you watching on YouTube, thank you for taking time away from your busy schedule of kitten videos to check this out. So, my name is Dave Rolsky, and this presentation is called A Date with Perl. This mic seems overly loud. There's a bit of ringing. If you thought this was about dating advice, I'm sorry to tell you that this is the wrong presentation, I'm the wrong person to give it, and you're probably at the wrong conference for that entirely. This is going to be about dates and times in Perl. So I've done a lot of Perl stuff, including writing the date time. I'm going to try to talk really quiet because I feel like the mic is really loud. Okay, I'm going to talk really quiet because they need the mic for YouTube. I could try that. How's that? Is that better? Okay. So, yeah, I've done a lot of Perl stuff, including writing the datetime module and various other datetime things and lots of other stuff. So, first thing you need to know is that dates and times are completely insane. There's a lot of insanity that we'll cover. There's calendars and how weird they are. There's time zones, which are the worst thing ever, except for daylight saving time, which is really the worst thing ever, except for leap seconds, which, okay, that's the worst thing ever. But there's a lot of insanity to deal with in the date and time world. So if there's one thing you take away from this presentation, it's this. So definitely write your own date and time code. Just don't do it. Use something from CPAN. If you don't want to use DateTime, I don't know why you wouldn't want to use DateTime. It's the best thing ever. But there are other modules you could consider using. But definitely do not be writing this stuff from scratch, especially if you have to do any sort of date and time math or if you have to deal with time zones and DST. I guarantee if you write it from scratch, you'll get it wrong. I know I did. So yeah. All right, so let's talk a little bit about calendars. So probably many of you have heard of the Gregorian calendar. This is based on the Earth's revolution around the sun. This is what we currently use in pretty much all of the world as our main calendar, at least, and it's certainly the calendar of international communication. So the datetime.pm module implements the Gregorian calendar. So here's the basics of it. Hopefully you already know a lot of this. There's 365 days in a year, leap years add an extra day, and for the purposes of daytime, the daytime module, we say it begins in year one, day one, month one. In reality, it wasn't implemented until the past couple hundred years, and dates of adoption vary across different countries. I think the latest countries to adopt it were like Russia and some others, and adopted in the early 1900s. So, I said it starts on year one. Of course, you can then start counting backwards. So we have year zero, which is also referred to as 1 BC or BCE in some counting systems. We might need to tweak the leap year algorithm at some point around year 3000. So keep an eye out for that. Make sure you write code that handles that correctly, because the Earth's revolution around the sun is slowing down. So eventually, it's going to slow down so much that we'll probably just crash into the sun, except the sun will probably have expanded and swallowed the Earth by then either way. So takeaway, we're all doomed. So here's a really simple example of how you can use the datetime module for simple dates. So you make a new datetime, you give it a year, a month, a day, and you can ask for information from that object. So we can say the date, and it prints it out in what year, month, day format. We can ask for the month name, and it tells you it's June. There are many, many other things you can ask it to tell you about the name of the day, or what quarter you're in, or what week of the year you're in. You can read the docs to see all this. And of course, we can also do this in other languages. So if you pass a locale when you're constructing the datetime object, it will spit out the names in different languages, and there's coverage right now for most languages on Earth, and including coverage for the specific locales. So for example, French versus, Canadian French, or there's many, many, many different dialects of Spanish. And this affects not only things like the names of the days, which are probably the same in every Spanish-speaking country, but also the formatting, like the default formatting of dates. You know, so that will vary based on the country less as well as the language. So, and we also have modules out there for other calendars, and we can convert between them. So, for example, we could make a datetime object for, well, this was the current date when I did this last year. Then we can create a Chinese calendar object from that datetime object, and we can ask it for information about the Chinese calendar. So what cycle is it? What's the zodiac animal currently? What's the celestial stem and the terrestrial branch? Which is questions I know you're all burning to have answered, which are these things, which I can't, this is not the very small subset of Chinese that I can actually read, so I don't know what it says. All right. Any questions so far? That was basic calendar stuff. Hopefully most of that was pretty much review for you. All right, so then let's talk about time. So that's based, of course, on the length of a day, one rotation of the Earth around its axis. So a day mostly has 24 hours, and in the daytime module, we count from hour zero to hour 23. An hour has 60 minutes. Most minutes have 60 seconds, not all of them. Therefore, most days have 86,400 seconds. But again, not all of them. And I mentioned leap seconds earlier, and that's where this comes in. Worst thing ever. All right, so then there's this thing called atomic clocks you might have heard of. And that's a way of measuring the length of a second based on something about physics that I don't understand. I majored in music, so this is just gobbledygook to me. I don't know. They're like atoms, vibrations, decay, cesium, something, something, wah, 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 wah. All I know is it's very accurate. So the length of a second never changes when it's measured by an atomic clock. And TAI, which is, I believe, Toms Atomique International, is the international atomic time standard that everybody has agreed to use. And the reason that's important is it ties into leap seconds. So this is the worst thing ever. So not only is the Earth's revolution around the sun slowing down, but its rotation around the axis is also slowing down. However, since the length of a second is tied to atomic clocks, the length of a second is not changing. So every once in a while, we need to resync midnight so it's actually the middle of the night. So we announce a leap second. And when I say we, there's some bunch of people in France who do this, who are constantly measuring the speed of the Earth. So every once in a while, they declare that there will be an extra second in some day coming up in a few months. It's either, I think, June 1st or December 1st or something like that. It's always fixed. It can happen no more often than every 6 months. And in theory, they can actually announce two extra seconds, or in the case the Earth speeds up, which apparently in theory it can, they could subtract a second or two. I've never seen that happen. So far, they've just added 1 second. So then there's this thing where we try to deal with the atomic length of time versus the actual length of a day. It's called UTC. The English name is Coordinated Universal Time. The French name is Temps Universel Coordonné. And the acronym is UTC. I love this. This is just like such a great example of like international politics at work. So we couldn't, neither the English speakers nor the French speakers were apparently willing to give, so the acronym we come up with is neither. I love it. So UTC is this atomic time, and then you add the leap seconds that we've had so far in history, really there's been 34, and that's really what we use as the current world standard for measuring time is UTC. At least for kind of wall clocks and the clocks on your computer and stuff like that. People who are actually doing, say, physics and things like that will generally just use TAI, T-A-I, and not worry about leap seconds because they're really just concerned about how long things take. So this is based on the time in Greenwich, England. You might have heard the term Greenwich Mean Time before, and it's kind of basically the same thing as UTC. And then all time zones are based on an offset from UTC, which means all time zones, of course, include these horrible leap seconds. All right, are you with me? Yeah, question.
So if we don't know when every second's being added, how does it calculate future dates?
So the question was, if we don't know when leap seconds are being added, how do we calculate future dates? And the answer for that is incorrectly. So every time a leap second is announced, I have to do a new release of datetime.pm because it just ships with like a list of them. There's no other way to deal with this. But actually, when I say incorrectly, that's not really true because it's correct as of right now. There are no additional leap seconds, so the calculations are correct. As soon as it's announced, it's incorrect and you should update datetime. Now, in practice, this really doesn't matter that much for about 99% of applications. So if you just use the existing version of datetime that you've been using, it's really not going to break anything. But in fact, I sometimes wish I'd never included leap seconds in the main datetime class at all. It would have made my life simpler and people wouldn't have to think about it, but it's in there. I was trying to be correct. All right, so time zones. So time zones are political, which means they're crap. They change all the time for the stupidest reasons. So the latest change that was driving me out of my mind is apparently Morocco has decided that their daylight saving transition is going to be based on the end of Ramadan. Now, I have nothing against Ramadan, great holiday, but it's based on the Islamic calendar, not the Gregorian calendar. So every year, the DST transition is going to happen at a time that's completely unpredictable if you're just looking at the Gregorian calendar. And in fact, the existing tools that we use for kind of managing time zones, which I'll talk about in a second, have no way of representing this according to the Islamic calendar. So they just have to pre-calculate the Islamic calendar for the next 400 years in order to get an approximation of the right answer. Why they decided to do this, I don't know. Why they couldn't have just said, screw DST, it's really stupid. That certainly would have made life easier. There was also, for example, the last US DST change, which was supposed to save energy and probably just killed a few people. In fact, DST changes kill people because when you get less sleep, the night when you lose an hour, you sleep less and people get into accidents or are higher stress and then they have heart attacks. So yeah, not only is DST stupid, but it kills.
But and it saves life. You get 1 hour, have more sleep.
That probably just screws people's schedules up, and then they're running late for something because their schedule's off, and then they drive too fast and have an accident. So all right, so yeah, so time zones are political. They will change. I've seen changes announced, like I think this happened in Argentina a few years ago, or like, yeah, next Thursday we're going to have a change to the whole thing, which is horrible. So there's this database called the Olson time zone database, but now it's called the IANA time zone database because the guy who created it, Arthur David Olson, is now retired. So it's an open source data and software project. Microsoft, of course, has to do their own thing because it's Microsoft. Now, surprisingly, Apple doesn't, because Apple's all about like inventing their own shit. Like, oh, let's make a new port. Oh, let's make a new display adapter, whatever. But in this case, they're actually using this database, thankfully. But Microsoft has its own system. Daytime time zone module ships with something that converts between them, but it's not that up to date because I refuse to use Windows. So if you use Windows and find that there's some problems, patches are very much welcome. So the basics of time zones. It's an offset in minutes and hours from UTC. Right now, Orlando is -4 hours, so we're 4 hours behind the current UTC time. Time zones also have a name, and generally most of the names are a continent or an ocean followed by a city. So we have something like America, Chicago. Right now we're in the America / New York time zone, Asia, Taipei, Pacific, Fiji, blah, blah, blah. Sometimes we have names with three parts because the countries have just gone crazy, or in the case of Indiana, the state has gone crazy and you just need more specificity to label the time zone. So we have like America, Argentina, San Juan, and there's like a, I don't know, 5 time zones in Indiana, because apparently living in the Midwest drives you mad. I live in Minneapolis, so I guess I'm a testament to that fact. So what a time zone really is a collection of rules about historical and future DST changes. So it basically says something like, the last Sunday of March will move the clocks forward an hour at 1 a.m. local time, or the first Tuesday of October, we'll move the clocks back an hour at 12 a.m. UTC time, and there's a lot of ways to define these rules. They also define short names that you might be familiar with, like CDT or EDT. I highly recommend that you not try to use these for anything other than displaying to end users, because these names are not unique. So for a while, EST referred to both the time zone we're in during the winter here, as well as a time zone in Australia. So if you ask a user to type in their time zone or pick from a time zone list that's just these short names, then that's not very helpful. And there's no guarantee that the short names will be unique at any given time. So really, these are just for display purposes only. If you want users to select a time zone, you have to really ask them what city they're in or what city is nearest, or you know, give them a list of cities, say what city is in the same time zone as you. Okay, Chicago or New York or whatever. So another thing to realize is that this database has a lot of historical time zones that are now exactly the same as kind of the main time zone for the region. So there's a time zone called America Menominee, which I just love to say, Menominee, 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 which is a city in Wisconsin. It's been the same, it's been following the same rules as Chicago since, I don't know, the 70s or so. Before the 70s, there were a lot more variations in local time zones around the world. So yeah, Menominee moves from Eastern to Central. Right now, there's no API for finding what time zones are actually kind of current and which ones are historical only. I've done this talk for a few years, and I've been saying yet for years, so this is clearly just wishful thinking. Nobody's gone and coded this. It would be really useful to have some way to do it, or also just to have some way to say, you know, are these two, you know, which time zones are the same for the current dates and future dates? But I suspect what most people end up doing is just kind of hand-picking the time zones they want to show users for selection. It's hard to get away from that. So, of course, you can use all these time zones with the DateTime module. So when we create a time zone, when we create a DateTime object, we can set the time zone when we create the object. If we ask for the DateTime in America, Chicago on that date, it'll tell us what it is. Then we can set the time zone to some other time zone. It adjusts the local time, leaving the UTC time the same. And then you can print that out and figure out what time it is there. This is a reference to a very obscure Taiwanese film that I'm sure you all saw called What Time Is It There? So this is, you know, obviously useful for a lot of things. You want to figure out, you know, like some sort of meeting scheduling for people across different time zones. You need to be able to present the information in their local time zone. There's also this thing called the floating time zone, which is really the absence of a time zone, or maybe think of it as the undef of time zones. So if you set the time zone to floating, then you don't have a time zone, and when you convert to a real time zone, say I called set time zone on this object and set it to Asia Taipei, then the local time would be unchanged. So this can be useful for various things. Also, no leap seconds for these time zones, because time zone leap seconds are fixed to UTC. So without knowing what time zone you're in, we can't do leap seconds. This can be useful if you just don't want to think about time zones or leap seconds at all. Just make all your datetimes floating, then you don't have to think about it. This is, you know, which is fine if all your times are in just one time zone and you never need to worry about converting to another. So yeah, so we make a datetime object, set the time zone to floating, then we set the time zone later, the local time is unchanged. Now if we set the time zone again to some non-floating zone, the local time will change. If we set it back to floating, then of course the local time remains unchanged. So that all makes sense. By the way, do feel free to just interrupt with questions. It's not just William who gets to, but of course it's William who will. Yeah, go ahead. So the question was, if I want to change the time zone for a daytime object without changing the local time, and it is currently in a real time zone, a non-floating zone, would I just change it to floating and then as an intermediate step and then to the other time zone? The answer is yes, that will work just fine. Another question?
Yeah, What's the difference between floating and Greenwich?
Okay, what's the difference between floating and Greenwich? Okay, first of all, there's no Greenwich. It's UTC now, or Europe, London, which are actually two different things. Greenwich Mean Time was the old name for UTC before the whole agreement that came up with the UTC acronym. So floating has no relationship to UTC. Greenwich or UTC time zone is plus 0 hours from UTC. So if the daytime object is set to the UTC time zone, and then say you set it to American New York, it's going to subtract 4 hours from the local time. Well, right now, because we're in DST. Whereas if it was floating and then you set it to American New York, the local time just is untouched. So yeah, they're definitely not interchangeable. Although keeping everything in UTC is also a perfectly valid approach to dealing with time zones, and I'll talk about that more later. All right, so another concept. There's this thing called the epoch, and an epoch is just any arbitrary starting point for a calendar. The Unix epoch is this. It's midnight, 1970, January 1st, at UTC specifically. So with the Unix epoch, we count it in seconds since this date time. Now, we say it's UTC, but it's not really. POSIX actually skips leap seconds, and if you were to obsessively update with NTP when a leap second was going into effect, you'd see the very exciting phenomenon of two consecutive seconds, both labeled second 59 on your computer during that time, which, I mean, the thrill would be intense. So POSIX doesn't recognize leap seconds, but it kind of accounts for them, which is very weird. So it's kind of neither time nor UTC, but it basically follows along with UTC closely enough. It's close enough for programming, right? Programming's a lot like horseshoes and hand grenades. We just try to get close enough. All right, so you can calculate the epoch from a daytime object. So we make an arbitrary daytime object, and we ask for the epoch, and it prints it out. Very straightforward. You can, of course, also construct a datetime object from an epoch. There's a method called new from epoch. You pass in the epoch, and then you get a datetime object. So you can go back and forth. So there's also a Y2.038K problem, which is going to happen, well, in year 2038, at some point in the middle of the year or so. Beginning of the year. So the epoch's not going to fit in a 32-bit integer at that point. So the epochs on Unix systems are represented as signed 32-bit integers, at least on 32-bit systems. So you might think that's not such a problem, but the thing is, if you're using epochs to calculate mortgages on a 32-bit system, well, last year you were already screwed. In fact, you were screwed in 2008. Of course, nowadays, most new systems people are setting up are probably 64-bit. They use a 64-bit epoch as a Perl 512. Perl always uses a 64-bit epoch internally, which is very nice. Really, this is probably more of an issue for potentially like embedded systems, which will probably continue to be 32-bit, at least for a while. And just something to remember in the back of your head. If you're on a 32-bit system, be careful about how you use epochs. So the datetime ecosystem is pretty large. There's a lot of types of modules. There's modules which can take a datetime object and format it according to some format like ISO 8601 or MySQL or HTTP format or this mail RFC 2822 format. There's modules which represent other calendars. We saw Chinese earlier. I believe there's also Islamic and Hebrew and Japanese and Discordian and a few others. So there's like both made up calendar, well, all calendars are made up. I think there also might even be some fictional calendars. There's modules for representing events and recurrences. So you could add, there's a module for calculating like Easter. There's modules for representing the concept of weekly recurring events or daily or every whatever you want to do. There's also a bunch of modules in the datetime X namespace where I ask people to put stuff that doesn't fit in these other categories. So there's a datetime X module for doing fiscal datetime math, which I don't understand. I don't work in the fiscal world, so it's got something to do with quarters and stuff. Anyway, if you work in that world, you might want to take a look at it. It might be useful to you. So yeah, there's a huge ecosystem of modules that all interoperate with the time module, which I think is very useful. If there's something you need to solve, there might be a solution for you. Oh, one module I do want to highlight is the datetime set distribution, which is really useful. It lets you represent a set of datetimes as well as datetime spans. So from like, you know, midnight to the end of the day or a whole week, you can also have sets of spans, and then you can say, oh, is this datetime, is this individual instance of a datetime part of this set or part of the span, which can be really useful. All right, so now I want to talk about just kind of my recommendations and also the mistakes I made with datetime. I should point out, so yeah, I wrote datetime, I don't know, 13 years ago now. I forget when the first release was. I was young, I was naive, optimistic, foolish, with joy in my heart, and that's all gone. That's all gone now. So if I could do it all over again, I'd do it better. But there's a lot of, you just have to deal with my mistakes. At some point, somebody might release something that's better. In fact, there's a module somebody pointed me at on CPAN called Time Moment, which is largely datetime compatible in some of the basic ways and fixes some of the APIs in other ways, so it might be useful. So first thing I would have done is make a datetime date class. So if you just wanted to deal with dates, you wouldn't also have to think about times. You can kind of simulate that by using just the floating time zone for all your datetime objects, and then using these two methods for math, delta MD, which is months and days, or delta days. So if you use those for math, you'll never touch the time portion of the datetime, and you can effectively just ignore it. There's also another stupid piece of the API. So let's say we want to figure out the difference in days between due date times. So we make our two date times. We call the delta days method, which returns the date time duration object. If you want to actually get the days out, you have to use this stupid in units method. It does have a days method, but that'll give you something like six. The reason being that it also has a weeks method, and if you ask for the weeks, it'll give you that as well, and it also has a years method. So it's just kind of confusing and stupid. So just know that if you want to get a specific unit out, you have to use in units. Sorry. So yeah, the API is really stupid. All right, any questions on my stupidity? But there's more. So yeah, so if you do delta days and then you call days on it, it gives six, but then you ask for the weeks and it tells you there's 2060, you could do the math yourself. You could just call it in units to get the answer you really wanted. All right, let's talk about datetime math. It's in really insane. So one question you might want to figure out is how long is a month, which gets really confusing. So you make some arbitrary datetime, let's say for 2009, February 1st, then we add 28 days, now we're at March 1st. We add another 28 days, now we're at March 29th. I think that all makes sense to you why that would happen, because February is 28 days long, but March is 30 or 31. I can't remember the song that tells you. So, okay, let's add a month instead of 28 days. So how about we add a month to January 30th? Well, if we do that, we end up with March 2nd. Then we add another month, and we're at April 2nd. Why does that happen? Okay, let's try this again. So we're going to add a month, but we're going to set the end of month parameter, which tells datetime duration how to handle when you add one or more months and it does some sort of wrapping. So if we set it to limit, it won't go past the end of the month. So now we add a month to January 30th. We're at February 28th. Of course, now we add another month and we're at March 28th, but maybe you really wanted to be on the last day of March when you added that. So there's actually another parameter called preserve, I believe, that if you add a month and you're on the last day, it will always take you to the last day of the next month, no matter how many days away that is. And you're thinking, well, this is really horrible. Why didn't you just make this smarter? The problem is, one person smarter is another person stupider, because you have to actually know what you want when you do date time math. And that's kind of the theme of a lot of these slides. There's no set of defaults I could have picked that is the right set of defaults. The right set of defaults is the one that works for your app, and you're going to have to figure that out. Unfortunately, and this is one of the things I hate most about daytime, is there's nothing I could do that would prevent you from having to think about all these things. Whatever set of defaults I picked will work for some people and not work for others. So you're just going to have to, oh my God, I hate to say this, read the documentation. I know that's a lot to ask, but you're going to have to read the documentation to figure out how this works. And there's a lot in the docs about all the kind of caveats for date time math that you might have to deal with. This is another fun thing, is to try to figure out how long a day is. So we make 2012. It's November 4th. The hour is midnight. The streets are cold. One man. No, wait, sorry, something else. All right, so it's midnight. We add an hour. Logically, this makes sense. Now it's 1 a.m. Then we add another hour, and it's still 1 a.m. Okay, so why'd that happen? Well, there's a DST transition where the local time goes back an hour. So that's the second 1 a.m. of the night. So this day is 25 hours long, at least on the local clock. Of course, if you do this all in UTC, it's always 24 hours long. You don't have to worry about these problems, but sometimes you need to do math using the local time. So, yeah? So the question was, I'm not sure I understood the question, but how does it know which UTC it is when you add the hour? Okay, so the UTC time or date time for the object when it's created is completely unambiguous. At November 4th at midnight, we know what the time zone is. We know we're at -6. I can never remember these. We're at -6, and then at 1 a.m. local time, when the clock goes from 1:59:59 to 2, it jumps back an hour, and we're at, no. We're at -5, then we went to -6.
But if you create the object at 1 a.m.
If you create the object at 1 a.m., I think it always picks the either earliest or latest UTC time. When you create an object, which would be ambiguous, the docs tell you it'll do something. It does the same thing every time. It might not be what you want, but at least it's the same thing every time. You could, of course, create it in UTC and then convert it to the local time zone. So, yeah, there's no way to work around this. This is just one of the problems with datetimes. This is another fun problem. So it's March 11th at midnight in 2012. We add an hour, it's 1 a.m. We add another hour, it's 3 a.m. So on this particular DST transition, we jump forward an hour. So there is no local 2 to 2:59:59. It just doesn't exist, which has really fun implications for those of you doing daytime math. So let's say we create the day before, March 10th at 2 a.m. That time exists. Then we add a day. It's going to throw an exception because there is no 2 a.m. and I don't know what the hell you want me to do. So if you want to work around this, I think I'll talk about this later, you can just do everything in UTC, which is a reasonable approach. Also, if you try to create this date time of March 11th, 2 a.m., you'll get, with America Chicago as the time zone, you will get an exception because it just says this is not invalid local time for date and time zone. Yeah, question.
Instead of adding one day, you add 24 hours. Will it do that correctly?
Is that what I do on the next slide? No. So the question was, if instead of one day, I add 24 hours, what happens? Yeah, that works fine. So you can kind of think of the math as kind of, there's a bunch of counters of separate units. So if we roll the day counter forward and the time remains unchanged, that's broken. But if we roll the time counter, the hour counter forward, 24 times, then the second to last is 1, and then we roll it forward again, and it's 3, and it works fine. So yeah, you can add 24 hours. But then the local time changes. So again, you have to decide what you want to do. Do I want to do local math? Okay, then I'm always going to add 24 hours instead of a day and know that the local times are going to change. the local hour is going to change at some point, or I'm going to convert to UTC, add my days, and then convert back. You just have to pick. Also, the order of math matters. So for a reason I no longer remember, because I wrote this code so long ago, I picked a fairly arbitrary order, which is documented. So if you add months and days together, I believe, yeah, it adds the days first and then the months. So we start with February 28th, 2011. We add one day, we get March 1st. We add a month, we get April 1st. If we did it the other way and added the month first, we'd get March 28th, and then we add a day and get March 29th. So the order of operations matters, and this is well documented in the docs. The solution, I should put the solutions on these slides too. The solution is, if you want to control the order, you can just call add multiple times in a row. So you can decide which unit gets added first. All right, so some more gotchas. So the math is not reversible. So if I subtract two date times and then add a duration, and then I add that duration back to the original, to the second date time, I might get a different date time object than I started with. This is explained at great length in the docs if you want to see the cases where this can happen. Again, it has to do with DST changes just being insane. So also, if we subtract a DST date in a time zone, or non-DST from DST in the same time zone, it's very arbitrary what this should produce. Does the duration include the DST changes hour? Does it not? Again, this is all defined in the docs as to what it will do. And then leap years and leap seconds can also produce occasionally surprising results. So, I do talk about solutions. That's good. So, this is something else. So when you want to do math, always use the mathy method. So I've add, subtract, delta days, blah, 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 okay? Do not ever write something like we see on that second bullet point. Somebody wrote me email, was like, hey, this is breaking. So if you do this, you're very, very easily going to end up with invalid local times. So this is not how you do math. Let datetime do math for you internally. Of course, you can still end up with invalid local times, but you're more likely to make a mess doing this, especially if you do, this way, if you did, you can't even do it with hours. So I don't know why somebody thought this was the way to do math, but it's not. Use the floating time zone if you can. If you don't care about time zones, then using the floating time zone will avoid about 90% of the problems I just mentioned, because they pretty much, most of the problems have to do with DST. If you can't use the floating time zone, then do math in DST, in UTC. So just convert the object to UTC, do your math, convert back to the local time zone. You'll never end up with that exception about invalid local times. And in fact, our internal wrapper that we use at work is kind of a wraparound datetime, and one of the things it does is whenever you call any sort of math method, internally it converts the object to UTC, does the math, and then converts it back to the original time zone, which is, of course, a little slower, but also means we don't have to catch exceptions when we do add or subtract or anything. All right. I think I already covered this. And I'll answer the question about what does datetime pick when there's an ambiguous local time. So it picks the latest UTC time. So whoever asked that or mentioned that, there you go. So I also have some recommendations for kind of storage and presentation. So whenever possible, you should store either a floating datetime or store the datetime in UTC if you can. You can also store them as a datetime plus time zone if that's a type in your database. However, that's still not perfect. The problem is Postgres stores the time zone just as an offset. It doesn't store the Olson name of the time zone. So there are plenty of time zones that are -5 hours. In fact, both America, New York, and America, Chicago can be -5 hours from UTC at different times of the year. So if you're going to store if you need to store the local time zone, you have to also store that name if you want to pull it out and present it to the user in the right way. I recommend not storing in Epic and not operating on Epics. It's likely to lead to you to want to do math on the Epic, which is really not a great idea. Just store the datetime. If you're using a real database like Postgres and not MySQL, then Postgres actually has pretty good support for dates and times. MySQL, of course, thinks year zero, month zero, day zero is a date, so I don't know what to do with MySQL other than shoot it. But anyway, so if you're storing everything in UTC like I'm recommending, you could also store the user's preferred local time zone. So what I suggest is just convert to the local time zone on presentation to the user. So think of time zones less as things that you store with the date time and more as things that you present to users. Now, this doesn't work for everything. If you're doing a multi-user calendar system with people in multiple time zones, you're pretty much stuck storing the time zone that they created the appointment at. But if you're not doing something that complicated, you might be able to get away with just using time zones for presentation. Never just store the datetime in the machine's current local time zone. I say this having done this myself, embarrassingly enough. Especially if you move to like a different server that happens to be in a different local time zone, you're really going to regret this. So be explicit about the time zones you use. If you're using, you know, something like current timestamp or now in your database, make sure that you're getting a UTC time out of it, not just whatever the server happens to be set to. So, all right. Also, some performance tricks. So, datetime can be a little slow. Now, these are my rules of optimization. I think they're pretty straightforward. I wrote these for a coworker of mine who really liked to optimize things and would write like crazy code because he was like, "It's faster." It's like, "How do you know it's faster?" "Oh, I know." Okay, so. Yeah, these are good rules. These are not just daytime specific. These are rules you should take with you everywhere. I mean, not that I'm against fast code. I'm all for things going as fast as possible, but you should not be optimizing when you're writing something the first time. Optimize it later. All right, so one very simple optimization, which you won't do without benchmarking and profiling first. Actually, you can do this anytime. It's perfectly safe. If every time you create a datetime object, you pass the time zone as a name, then the datetime time zone module has to look that up and potentially try to load it from disk or see that it's already loaded and has to make sure it's a valid name and all this crap. What you can do instead is create the datetime time zone object separately and then pass that object for the time zone parameter. So if you're always using the same time zone when you're creating it, whether it be UTC or local time or whatever, just do this. Very straightforward and simple. And especially if you're creating thousands of datetime objects, this can actually make a big difference. The datetime format modules have parsers. They're like, it's format as in a noun, not as a verb. So it handles a format, so it parses and outputs in that format. If you're dealing with a lot of datetimes that are all in the same format and you know that they'll always come back in the same format, you could not use a formatter at all because those can be a little slower. You can just use a regex. That's perfectly OK if you know that you're dealing with good data, or in the case of MySQL, known to be bad in a specific way, all the time data. So you don't have to use a formatter. That said, if you're not having to construct thousands and thousands of datetime objects at a time, just use the formatter. Your code will read better and will be a little more robust against future changes. You can also turn off validation that datetime does internally. Again, you really better know that your data is always valid. So if you do this little magic incantation before creating a datetime, it disables most of what params validate does internally. Params validate is what datetime uses to do its validation. So this is an okay strategy. Again, if you're creating thousands of datetimes at once, this can speed it up drastically. But you better be damn sure that your data is correct, because datetime will not handle bad data. So if you set the data 32 and you turn this off, I don't know what's going to happen. Something very wrong. And it will go wrong without telling you. So that's why I say be very careful. All right, that's the end of the presentation. Does anyone have any questions for me? Yes. So the question was, what's the alternative to leap seconds? Well, what's actually, and I'm not making this up, what has been discussed is to just change it to leap minutes or hours. So if it was a leap hour, we probably wouldn't have to deal with it for something like 7, 8, 9,000 years, which is fine with me, because I suspect there's a very good chance I'll be dead by the time a leap hour comes up. Even with a leap minute, we've only had 34 leap seconds since whenever UTC started in the early 70s. So we're not gonna get to 3,600 leap seconds anytime, or 60 leap seconds anytime soon, or another 60. Probably wouldn't happen in my lifetime. So really, I just want to not have to think about it ever again. I don't care what other people have to deal with, programmers of the future. I don't have any kids, I have no plans to have kids, so. Screw the children, that's what I say. They can deal with the leap minutes.
So,
yeah.
So worst case with leap hours, it's still not as bad as a single daylight saving change, right?
Yeah, so the question was, worst case with leap hours is still not as bad as a DST change. Yeah, at least it happens a lot less often. I mean, the other option is just to give up and not sync midnight or something. The drift is so incredibly slow that I'm not sure how much it matters. Yeah, question.
Yes, I hadn't used the datetime method of add delta y m d h m s. I don't know what's wrong, and it just failed.
So he called a method delta YMD HMS, and it failed. I don't know. I'd have to look at your code.
But there's no any other error provided.
I can take a look at your code after.
I tried to catch the dollar pound sign.
My
my
psychic powers are on the fritz right now. So I can't read your mind and see the code on your screen, but I can look at it afterwards. There could be a bug in daytime, there could be a bug in your code, there could be cosmic rays hitting your computer. All right, I'll take a look. Yes. There's a daytime module in Perl 6 as well. Are they working with me? I've had some input into it. So yeah, I participate a little. I think that it'll be good. It'll be much better than what's included with Perl 5. So there probably will still need to be modules for Perl 6 for this stuff, just because it would be a bit ridiculous to include everything that daytime and kind of other things in the daytime ecosystem do in the core, but the core will be sufficient for much more usages, many more usages, English hard. Yes. XKCD.
Yes, they said that there's an ISO standard for dates, for writing dates. Would you favor military intervention to any country that doesn't follow the standard?
So the question was, XKCD said that there's an ISO standard for dates. Would I favor, I'm not sure how XKCD segues into this, would I favor military intervention into any country that doesn't follow this? Probably not. I think the history of Western U.S. military interventions recently has been pretty. Those groups then went to war with each other over that standard. I think that's the most likely outcome. So I'd have to say no, not because it wouldn't be good to get everybody on the same standard, just because the likely outcome is to make things much worse. So, yeah. Any real questions? Yes.
Yeah, for the alternative of the daytime, I use MySQL. MySQL have timezone functions.
Mm-hmm.
Database already there.
Oh, okay. So you're saying there's MySQL date functions that handle time zones, but it's only 32-bit. Is that what you're saying?
Right.
Okay. But MySQL sucks in so many other ways as well that you shouldn't use it anyway. It's just steaming pile of trash. It's a steaming pile of trash that people can make work, but it's still a steaming pile. Again, so Wendy's telling me I should stop. If you have any other questions for me or any other psychic debugging you'd like me to do, I'll be performing at the local carnival, or you can find me around the conference and ask me other questions. Thanks so much for coming.